But it also has the ability to accommodate any kind of vehicle. So the entire Pier Park is designed for that flexibility in terms of vehicles. Likewise, the North Bridge has the same flexibility and capacity. The advantage of doing a project like this and trying to maximize that expanse over water gives us the flexibility to make sure that the maneuverability of those vehicles, pedestrians, and bicyclists are maintained and easily dealt with. But it's important to note, even though the service access for this project is very simple and quite easy, this is a pedestrian and cyclist-focused place. This is about being a park and about being a public place that is an extension of the city of St. Petersburg's park system. We're going to share with you a series of diagrams. This one in particular just gives you a sense of the sort of the vehicle connectivity and the loops that we've created. So you see on the left side the actual connectivity back to the city of St. Petersburg. And then on the right, the Pier Park and the loop that we've created. So the ability for whether it's a pedestrian or a cyclist, a tram, or an actual emergency vehicle, we've designed it in such a way that that vehicle can actually go all the way out to the overlook and circulate around the core and have easy access back and forth through the process. This diagram sort of emphasizes the possibilities of pedestrian-focused and cyclists throughout this park. What we're trying to do is show that there's many areas of access and the ability for a pedestrian and a cyclist to sort of coexist with those service vehicles is very easy and obtainable. We prepared some sections, and there's several in our handout. We wanted to share a couple. The image on the left gives you a sense of the bridge on the south and the bridge on the north. It's a 25-foot path. What we're showing there is a service vehicle, actually a fire truck. That would be the main access for an emergency situation. But the ability for a pedestrian to maneuver around those vehicles is not a problem. We also have a tram that would be service and do that loop in Pier Park. And the tram is sort of set up so that it can actually ride on the North Bridge as well. But service vehicles and emergency vehicles will have the same capability as you can see. The image on the right is the section through sort of the halfway point of Pier Park. It's sort of the largest expanse of the pier that goes out to the pier overlook. And you can see, again, the flexibility here for the vehicle to actually pass and go by any event, whatever the case may be. This is the area that we sort of set up as the opportunity for festivals and crafts, fairs, and food trucks, and things like that. As we move further out towards the pier overlook, this gives you a good sense of the sectional quality of the event space and what we're trying to achieve at the pier overlook. We talked about how we're maintaining the caissons at the pier and utilizing that sort of center core, both from an elevator standpoint and an egress staircase standpoint, and having the ability to get access up to these four levels. The image here gives you a good sense of what happens on the pier level, the main pier deck, where serviceability is maintained and happens at the pier overlook. Giving a vehicle, whatever that is, whether it's a service truck, a garbage truck, an emergency vehicle, or a person getting dropped off for an event, whether it's an accessible issue, that can be accommodated here on that level. So sort of a segue from circulation to service will give you a good sense of what happens at the pier overlook. So I talk about in sectional quality, those four levels of pier overlook. This is an image of our proposed pier overlook bar and grill. This is a 7,600 square foot space, air conditioned space, that could be adapted to whatever use the city wants, but we're proposing a simple casual dining experience. This is the diagram that gives you a good sense of how these levels can work, and you see the path that happens actually on the pier level. That diagram shows how the loop is maintained and wraps around the bottom level. And on each level, there's an opportunity, of course, not only for lobby space that's air conditioned and restrooms, but the ability to have a hidden service, or at least not so exposed to the public. It's important to note that what we're trying to do here is you go all the way up to the fourth level, there's ability to create various spaces for uses like control rooms, kitchen and storage, but having easy access to actual controlled and very dedicated service areas. When you look at this plan, this is sort of giving you a sense that, you know, probably out of all of the competitors, we're the only one that has the ability to take the service aspect of the project and hide it in some way. It's actually tucked underneath the second level, so it's completely covered from the rain. It's completely covered from the sun. And you have the ability to take this dedicated loading zone you see to the north, and whether it's for garbage, for simple deliveries and things like that, there's easily maintained and there's a direct access to a freight elevator in this area. Likewise, just from an accessibility standpoint, the Pier Park is fully accessible in terms of ADA access, whether it's to the water and most particularly to this event space. The tram stop actually comes to this zone and is completely covered from the rain, completely covered from the sun, and you have the ability to get off that tram stop and enter a air-conditioned lobby space that will take you again to every level of Pier Park overlook. In this particular diagram, you can actually see the opportunity for not only the elevator lobby, but significant restrooms. You asked us the question to address restrooms. And what we want to state is basically we have approximately 70 fixtures throughout Pier Park, most of them concentrated here, so we can deal with an event of up to 4,000 people. So what we were really trying to achieve here is having a great park and make sure that we never have a sea of porta potties. That was really important to us. The next topic of discussion was floating docks. We got several questions in regard to that. We wanted to address those issues, and I'm going to let Vince take over.
So there have been a number of questions about the durability and use of floating docks in our scheme. As we've indicated, we've elected to use floating docks in our scheme because we think they're simply the best way to get people down to the water and for various number of various recreational activities, be it putting your feet in the water, fishing, personal watercraft rental, or what be it. We've been talking to a manufacturer of modern six-sided floating dock, modern six-sided concrete floating dock systems. These manufacturers built over 150 marinas in Florida, over 50 of them using floating dock systems. The key to survivability of a floating dock system in a major weather event relates to connectivity of the modules to each other, the design of the pilings and anchoring systems, and the ability of the dock to raise over a storm surge. We've looked at this with their engineering department, and they have looked at the Moffitt and Nickel report. They're confident that they can design a system that will deal with the 4.5 to 5 foot significant wave heights and the 92 mile an hour winds that would occur in a 100 year storm in Tampa Bay. In fact, they just completed a marina in Fort Pierce with a Category 5 hurricane design that handles 180 mile an hour winds in that event. Regarding use, on a given day, Tampa Bay has a change of about 2 foot 4 inches in the water. All of our floating docks are connected via very generous gangways that allow them to be accessible, and the change over the course of the day would be barely perceptible. We also know that in high wind events, particularly in the fall and winter, that there could be wave surges of 2 feet or over. Regarding the ability, the use of a floating dock in wave surges and major wave events, there are a number of factors, including the size, weight, width, and the shape of the dock itself. The engineers I've been working with are very confident, particularly given the width of our major platforms, that in a 2 foot surge, being on one of these platforms would be akin to being on the deck of a large cruise ship. Of course, there will be times as you get above that where the city would have to set up rules about the crews being out on those docks. There was a question about the connectivity of the large platforms to fixed structures. And like our other structures, we would propose using a hinged gangplank system, which we feel can be incorporated into the deck of the floating platform that would allow the bottom seating step to go from a zero position to a 2 foot forward position, creating the bottom step over the course of the day. Of course, it happens very gently with the tide. It's important to note, however, that there is at each of these another major long gangplank that provides the accessible access to that position. That this is really connecting the seating steps, you know, the bleachers for the space. Going to the peer working group, we were asked to look at to create a chart of the requirements of the peer working group, and we've included that in your handout. We believe that we have accomplished all of the requirements of the peer working group. We have observation of viewing areas, dining options, cycling, walking, and jogging paths, transportation options, fishing opportunities, courtesy and transient docks for boaters, environmental education opportunities, flexible event and performance areas, bike and watercraft rentals, and depending on the setup and the use of the park at any given event, multiple opportunities for retail. We were asked to look at the Lambert Report and comment on its findings. The Lambert Report specifically notes Pier Park as including many of the programs and activities that it endorses as both economically viable and increasing visitorship. More importantly, the Lambert Report has many findings that we think support the underpinnings of the design of Pier Park. It notes of the existing pier the problem of the concentration of program in the pier head, and that the visit to that pier head requires an affirmative decision to go to that position. It suggests that that is a mistake not to be made again. It also notes that out of all of the original entries into this competition, that they didn't feel that any of them were iconic enough to be a draw in itself. That's not to say they are iconic, but they're not iconic enough to be a draw to themselves, like the Space Needle or the Eiffel Tower, or say. But they also point to a way to mediate against that. And we know this. Success looks different now. We know that great public space with great amenities makes for successful urban spaces. And as you see in this quote, they indicate that the success of the pier and the project can be decided looking at the extent that it's activated all the way from the shore through the pier to the pier head itself. And we believe we provided many, many opportunities for activity and economic activity included along the pier. We were asked to talk about what defines the identity of the pier. From the beginning, we've been committed to change the pier from the notion of traveling along a pier to have an experience, to the pier being the experience, and from having a pier and an icon to the pier being the icon. And we think this really builds upon the incredible founding vision of William Stroud and C. Perry Snell. When we talk about the inverted pyramid, you know, that's something that has maybe defined St. Petersburg for 45 or 50 years. The vision of the green waterfront of St. Petersburg being open and available for all has really defined and made St. Petersburg different for over a century now. And we think we built upon this, trying to connect the pier to the shore, to the city, and making it a combined experience where the pier finally becomes part of that chain instead of being contrasted. Building upon this ideal, it allows us to address the icon as an iconic structure that is comfortable within this park. An iconic folly. It fits within the park. It is both iconic and casual, providing shade and view. It constantly changes depending upon your position and the time of day, much like the sails and floating across in the bay.
I'd like to address the question that was raised about the relationship of Pier Park to the downtown waterfront master plan. And I think that it's easy for us to talk about how our project fits with the downtown waterfront master plan, because the Pier Park shares so much of the core vision and goals of that plan. The idea of connectivity to the water, a park for everyone, and relieving the pressure on the existing parks, such as Vinoy, with new park open spaces downtown. There are five key parts to the master plan vision that are core to the Pier Park scheme. First, the Pier Park is committed to, the Pier Park is committed to environmental stewardship. We believe very strongly, and we believe the Pier Park embodies sustainability, environmental education, and environmental experience. Two, Pier Park engages the experience of water. We've worked very hard and believe that getting people to the water, people want to be near the water, people want to put their feet in the water, they want to fish, they want to kayak, they want to understand the quality of the water. It's part of life. And we feel that engaging the water and being close to the water is really essential. Three, Pier Park is an active park system. It's diverse programming, it's active programming. It responds to all ages and all backgrounds. And it's a place that you can go if you have 50 cents or $50. It really appeals to everyone. Four, Pier Park contributes to an economically vibrant and diverse downtown. We believe that the activities in the park will foster and contribute to economic vitality downtown. And five, I think fundamental, is that Pier Park connects downtown to the waterfront. It's a series of linked spaces, continuous spaces that are green and programmed and active that actually pulls the waterfront out into the water and provides new experiences, and it works well with the existing parks that are in place. So the final consideration that we would like to leave you with today are a series of four questions. If the Lambert Report is the criteria by which you will choose, we think the Pier Park should be your choice. If the Pier Working Group is the criteria by which you will choose, we believe the Pier Park should be your choice as well. If the integration with the Downtown Waterfront Master Plan is the criteria by which you will choose, again, we believe the Pier Park should be your choice. And finally, if your criteria is a pier for everyone, for residents, visitors, and future generations, again, we believe the Pier Park should be your choice. So in closing, we hope the Pier Park is your choice, and we would be happy to answer any questions you have.
Very good, thank you. Any members? Questions to the team? Go ahead, Jerry.
I just want a one point of simple clarification on the very first question, Group 1, about permitting. You have the different square footages of the views. What's on the text and what's on the exhibit are scrambled. Is the exhibit correct or is the text correct?
The exhibit's correct.
Okay, thank you. That was, just want to confirm, so we're okay, the views are all reduced.
It's a mistake we caught earlier and immediately launched an email as well.
Okay. I thought that's what it was, but I just wanted to make sure. The questions about the floating docks, durability, et cetera, you gave several examples of where these have been installed, the company that you're talking about. The picture that everybody has talked about is the Vinoy Basin following a tropical storm. These other locations, have they survived storms that magnitude or greater?
Yeah, absolutely. We talked in specifically about a Category 4 design marina down at Crandon Park in Key Biscayne. And we also talked quite a bit about Vinoy. You know, people who design floating docks and piers know about what happened in Vinoy Basin. And it's a very specific set of circumstances that include the orientation of the basin, to the tides. And also the fact that the seawall backs up the floating docks right there, you get what's called wave amplification, right? The waves go in and they hit the seawall. They amplify and bounce back, so it's sort of doubling up the amount of disturbance that the piers are getting. And the way that these things are connected and understood, modeled, the engineer that we talked to did some very preliminary, I'm sorry, I don't know all of the, but I guess wave cast modeling based on the Moffitt and Nickel. And they're very comfortable that they can provide. And I'm not, and I don't, it's not that it's just them, they had a very good understanding of the situation, we're very confident that they could provide something that would be survive. These have been in operation in marine environments continuously for over 50 years, and we provided some other information about, you know, maintenance and refurbishment over that time.
Just one quick, I noticed that the elevation you're using, the 100-year surge is 8.3 feet. Is that adjusted for potential sea level rise? Or is it simply the historical storm surge?
It was we used the elevation that was in the design criteria from the project. Of course, we could look at all that.
If that had to be increased by 2 feet, would it,
yeah,
be,
I believe
would
that
it have really a large cost implication?
Yes. From my understanding, it did account for that. Because we had to raise the whole pier. You know, the whole pier is 2 feet higher than
the previous one. That answered it. Thank you.
I have several questions to make sure what you presented is not glossed over. Not in particular order. We look at your graphics, I think you're showing some different graphics than we've seen related to the structure at the pier. And what type of structure do you envision? And I ask that because you're showing graphics that depict something very efficient, but I don't believe I've heard what that concept is in basic terms. So it's a structural question.
The primary structure for the facility is concrete. So the platforms are concrete. There'll be every opportunity to actually extend the pier or the pile structures that go from the water that go through. And whatever we can maintain from a core standpoint, using the caissons and the actual core structure, we're going to build off of that. Then when you see the canopy structure, the shade canopy structure, our intent is to use aluminum with the fabric panels as well. So it's primarily concrete.
Okay, and I want clarification because you're showing this roof of service and you had only one drawing that had a vertical dimension, I believe 14 feet?
Correct.
Clear?
Correct.
So that 14 foot, you feel, will be maintained vision-wise because you're going to control the integrity of the structure that you're depicting in terms of an efficient stance.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
All right. Let's talk about the service roof. You show graphics, no dimensions. What size truck was that? You picked, you had four or five trucks parked side by side. What are those, the size of those trucks?
30-foot box trucks.
So those are the 30-foot box. Are we limited to 30-foot box trucks?
No, I think we can actually get an 18-wheeler through there. What was very, one of the things we studied was really just understanding primarily a fire truck, ladder truck, and having a 35-foot radius to actually make that turn, and we provide that.
I do think, though, for day-to-day service, you would want to limit the truck size because, you know, as we can accommodate service and emergency vehicles, but we are trying to create a primarily pedestrian experience, right? The pedestrian is prominent. So we can get service vehicles out there, you know, in scheduled times. In a major event, like a concert, you could have 18-wheelers deliver, set, you know, set up for the concert and things like that. But I don't think that you would want 18-wheelers going out there on a daily, you know, on a daily basis.
Or as we indicated in our handout, we specifically answered the question where we would suggest that that's actually managed by the city. So, you know, from a timing standpoint, that would only happen certain hours of the day.
Okay. One thing that I mentioned along that same vein and route is the issue of solid waste. And I don't see it. What is the answer?
On that lower, that pier level in the back where we had the loading dock, there's a 1,400 square foot back of house sort of interior loading zone. And we feel that that could accommodate, we could accommodate the solid waste within there for a scheduled day to pick up.
Okay, so more pointed, that would be sort of managed the way it's managed now, or managed differently?
I think it would probably be managed locally it's managed in a better manner because we have dedicated freight elevators that are segregated from the users that go down into a defined back of house space that has a loading area off of it. All of it screened and segregated from the visitor.
Okay. The gloss over bathrooms, I believe, you focus a lot about having bathrooms. If you're here, you have to deal with that occupancy. As I flip through, I see it. I want to make sure everybody understands your answer specifically. So when you get to the command, specifically where are bathrooms?
The locations where we have bathrooms, we'll start with the pier overlook. So as we indicated in that diagram, each level has bathrooms. It starts on the first level, and there's a significant restroom quantity there. And we've actually allocated those quantities within the chart that's in the book. And then it gets to the second level, and it sort of tapers off as it goes up because of the quantities of people. So the primary load and the quantity that we're dealing with on level one is greater as you move up. So there's probably about almost 60 total restrooms within the pier overlook itself, both men and women. And we're accommodating potty parity for the state of Florida. As you move down towards downtown, the education center has two restrooms. We were asked the question too, whether that is flexible enough to be used as a different type of space, and we indicated very clearly yes. So there's two fixtures, both men and women, within that facility, and it's completely equipped with utilities for whatever we want to use it for. As you move down to the changing room on Spa Beach that we're renovating, that is equipped with several, the quantity, just. I'm not sure what the quantity is, but there's seven men, seven women, I believe, in that area as well. So it adds up to about a total of 70 total.
Okay. Back to the floating docks. Different question, more structurally. These exhibits you show now clearly show a different profile to the actual floating dock. So has that profile in your review sort of been affirmed against the budget, and does it in any way answer the perception of the ability to dock in the rough waters of the bay in moments that are not that have been talked about publicly about boat docking and problems and not safe harbor? Mm-hmm.
So based on the information from the Moffitt Liquor Board, sending them our drawings. Of course, they haven't completely modeled it and priced it out. The company we've been speaking to believes that we felt that the docking system that they would use here falls within the budget that we've gone through with Skanska. Related to docking, really the only point where docking is an issue with the floating docks is the convenience dock at the end. And for the size and weight of the docks that we are looking at, the indication from the company is that they believe that they can that they can dampen the wave action from the exposed side to the backside by 50%. Right. So at the convenience dock on a day, if you're having 18-inch swell in the bay, you'll be 9-inch behind. So that on the kayak we have it's protected by the reef, so it's really not an issue there.
Okay, so because you changed the profile, I want to make sure.
I'd like to understand the change of the profile.
We changed the profile.
Well, I guess I'm seeing something more of a real condition that maybe I didn't really see.
Diagrammatic.
It's just
a diagram.
It's still diagrammatic.
Yeah.
Let me just show how that works. But we didn't physically draw the section. Basically, what we're working with in terms of working with this particular engineer and dock company is essentially a concrete encased system. Basically.
Okay, so it would address, this is not a leading question, it's a clarification question, does it address any potentials of upheaval?
Upheaval?
Right, so not a panel system, it's more of a envisioned as a singular effort?
They're all locked together, and they had, basically there's three levels that they locked them together with, right? So you have the modules of concrete, which are sort of as big as they can deliver under the delivery system that they're using via truck or barge. And then they had the lowest level was called a whaler system, where they do a kind of whaler. It's typically multiple layers of lumber around the outside that tie them together. That's the lowest system. And then they go to a lock system, and then they go to a post-tension system. And so as the greater the category of storm that you're designing for, the greater the strength that they use to create, you know, you tie all the modules together and try to get it to act as one. And in getting it to act as one, it as a unit is heavier and more stable because you don't have a bunch of little things floating around in the picture where you have one. Okay.
My last question for now, waterfront master plan suggests a green space where your items 1, 2, 3, and 4 exist, which is tram stop, bike share station, welcome plaza, and cultural road. So what is the answer from your team's perspective of how that would dovetail into the long term?
Well, so I think like all master plans, a master plan isn't designed. It's a series of desires, you know, things that need to go in that space to make it work.
And we are providing public open spaces in those areas. The groves are usable green spaces. The children's spray area is a usable public space. So the master plan shows a green lawn. We are showing the large green lawn at the end of the pier. But in lieu of that, we are putting in public spaces that are usable as parks.
There's another diagram in our book further back that indicates all of the elements that are indicated in the master plan and the elements that we've already incorporated in our uplands and then other elements that would be incorporated. But, you know, a master plan is a holistic vision. You know, the exact placement of things in that is part of the design. And we believe that not only have we met the intent of the master plan's vision, that we've also started to indicate how that vision might be implemented in a way that dovetails with the Pier Park design, so that it's not, you know, a design for the master plan and then a design for Pier Park.
I think the intent of the master plan is to actually pull the park spaces out toward and along the pier. And I think in that regard, we've been very successful in doing that.
Okay, I have one more question. Early in your presentation, you talked about the marine term. Okay, but again, this is another, what I call a gloss over moment. You're showing examples of turf in northern cities. So the issue is, how much command control do you have with the vegetation that would survive in a configuration like this in Florida?
In the chart that we provided, we worked with StanTech, our local engineers, and their landscape architects and staff. We used University of Florida turf matrix that looked at the different turf varieties that could be used in Central Florida relative to salt tolerance, durability, wear and tear, operations and maintenance, and cost. And it identified four species that would work in this circumstance. And those are the four species that we're recommending in the report. And the exact selection of either a species or a blend of species, which is probably more likely, would be a function of the particular use on the site, the slope aspect, or how the level of use that we thought we might have on the lawns. So we would choose from those four species that are listed in the report. And I would say the other thing about the turf lawn that is important is actually designing the soil and drainage environment properly, because the turf species is very important, but you need to actually designing the right soil conditions to work on a structure and have the right drainage. So we have been talking about a soil sand mix. Generally speaking, you need a fairly free draining soil. You need a certain amount of sand or even some aggregate mix in the soil so that the soil is, works in terms of not being compacted. Compaction is one of the major problems you have on urban lawns and usage. So the design of the soil and the drainage systems is, I think, as important as the action as the soil selection. Well, yeah.
You say the word, I want to make sure, because you talk about compaction, and I'm sorry to be technical, but I'm making you guys in control of this. So would that mean that do you envision the turf areas to definitely be off limit from vehicular type traffic, especially anything heavy than a lawnmower? Because that changes and starts getting into a maintenance issue.
Generally for public space, you would design the lawns for human activity and for the maintenance equipment necessary to mow and maintain the lawns. And those are generally lighter weight vehicles. But actually human activity produces a lot of soil compaction, and there's been a lot of work done on the engineered soils for public space lawns to design lawns that have the right soil structure to actually accommodate that compaction and to respond over time. And there have been enough of these lawns. Urban lawns are very popular contemporary thing, and there's been a lot of them done successfully. So there's a lot of research that we can draw upon and do draw upon.
See what happens when you ask a preeminent market technical. Committee members, other questions?
There is a lot more detail in the handout, so I hope you don't think we glossed over the answers. We really meant to get to all of them.
Not at all.
Can you just remind me of the elevations for the second and third overlook? Sorry.
The second.
I'm trying to find it desperately here.
The second level is approximately 16 and a half feet above the pier deck, the main pier deck. And then in each case, it rises up like every 16 feet. The top floor is lower than 16.
And you had briefly mentioned it, but just wanted to make sure the accessibility to the floating docks. You talked about an interlocking ramp. Yep. That's
every space at Pier Park is accessible. The heaviest slope that we have to get to any space is some of our shorter gangways that are narrow, so that they're designed to have a railing on both sides, are at 1 to 12, but everything else is at 1 to 20 miles.
And there's a diagram in the book that shows the accessibility.
It has all of the slopes.
Please confirm your scope includes irrigation system or your turf areas and the budget.
Yes, absolutely. Yeah.
Also confirm, when you met with the county on the permit, did they give you credit for your louver space in comparing the existing versus proposed? Because as I look at your silhouettes, it's not intuitive to me that you have less square footage than what's out there today.
Well, I think, in the conversation, we explained the design as best we could. I mean, and for the record, what David had indicated, he thought every one of those was permittable from their perspective. The question is whether it can get an administrative permit or go through a commission permit. And it was as simple as that. So when we talk about it, the way they measure it is simple. It's a two-dimensional exercise to understand what is vertical and what's not. Because I think even if we did a three-dimensional aspect, we could show that that shade structure is actually more transparent than a lot of those two-dimensional images. So the only way they can measure it is by simply measuring those north, south, west, and east elevations.
So that's the wrong way to apply, but does that mean they did not give you credit for the airspace through your respective louvers? Did they consider that solid?
No, they did give you credit for that.
They did. Okay.
Yeah, so what we measured was every aspect within that two-dimensional elevation that's solid was measured and compared it back to the existing.
Thank you. And not to dwell on it, but in light of the city's $1 million commitment for transient dockage in the Central Basin, and this community's inherent paranoia for floating docks' durability out in these open waters. Have you reconsidered your scope of transient dockage because of those two conditions?
Well, we had proposed, and we haven't talked about it because when we, you know, when we first did our proposal before we met with Skanska, you know, we were showing some kind of phase two stuff, you know, ideas about the master plan. We believe that the transient dockage belongs, you know, where the master plan has always shown it, and we've indicated the integration of that. The dockage out at the end is what we're calling a convenience dock. It's a place to pull up, get some bait, drop somebody off before you go to the transient dock. You know, it's a, you know, half hour dock. It is not a place to dock up, you know, instead. We've made it as long as we can to, because that's the best fit, you know, we've made it as long as we have to be able to get a couple of boats come in, and it's the best fishing spot out there. So could it be shorter? Absolutely. I think it's a good thing to have at the pier end, a place for boaters to be able to pull up, quickly drop off somewhere before they go off and get their transient slip.
Thank you. Just in final, I found the responses from your team to our questions as enlightening. I now get a much better feel for perhaps the most complex of all the concepts. And I think that's proportionate to the depth of thought put into your concepts. Well, I thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I had a couple of quick questions. I just want to clarify and partially for the audience as well. In the response to questions, you did say the dry classroom could be reconfigured as restaurant space. You would have the water room, sewer capacity, electrical capacity. The sloped lawn that is actually the top level of the lawn then would be about 16 feet above the pier deck, and then above the water then would be 26 feet or more above the water level. And the top level of the lawn is the roof of the tram level, right? So you're not on the same level as the tram.
So the idea is that you can get up onto that main level. The level below it is mostly service and then access.
Exactly. Out. So you're not seeing any of the tram service areas.
All of that area is completely screened from the building.
The other big question I had is just, you know, we've got this huge event lawn. What do we have in the way of capacity, like, you know, bringing in the actual lighting and sound structure for a stage? Is the, you know, how much, obviously electrical hopefully is there, but.
Well, our biggest plaza area is right at the access to the end where the stage would be of the event lawn, so it really provides a natural staging area where they can bring all that stuff in.
So they would, you would rely on the band to bring their equipment.
And that's what we were saying. I mean, we have to allow that occasionally there's going to be an 18-wheeler that at a scheduled time comes down here. But, you know, I don't think we would, the restaurant guy should just be telling any 18-wheeler they can drop off, you know, 20 pounds of beef.
So there's sufficient electrical in that where you would actually stage the bands and
yeah, we.
Good.
Our number in the budget that we provided for electrical for that, but also we have electrical infrastructure throughout so that you can set up events.
Any other questions, committee members?
One more. 7,600 square foot casual dining, because I think you're deliberate on casual, not destination. So what is the success that you envision with a restaurant of that size that's casual?
I would argue that casual dining can be destination. And one of the things that everybody you've spoken to, John, when people have visitors in the town, I'm sorry, I don't remember the name of it, but there's a restaurant that everybody takes their visitors to because it's all in the water. And it's a casual spot where they can get some appetizers and have a few beers and enjoy the most beautiful thing you have, which is this great waterfront. And so I don't think that a destination restaurant has to imply white tablecloths. I think we've provided the largest interior restaurant space of all the schemes, which has the best serviceability. If someone thinks that they can do a higher end restaurant there, you're leasing guys to decide that. But when we looked at what this thing is a place for everybody to be able to go enjoy the richness of St. Petersburg, that was our idea for it.
I also want to add too, we call it a casual dining. It's important to note that it's not just about that destination restaurant, but it's servicing every event that happens at the Pier Overlook. So if there's a concert, that facility could literally be the concession outlet for the entire event. So the ability for this structure to actually service any event that happens, whether it's a wedding,
the overlook.
Right. Or you could decide you could have the wedding inside the casual dining space. So you have the choice of air conditioned or open air. But that was the purpose of that space, having enough so that servicing every aspect of that area was easy to do.
And we also think, in terms of economic viability, that the premise of giving that space, the sort of concession, of being able to serve the wine and serve the Pier Overlook, gives them other sources of revenue. I mean, one of the things we've learned working on restaurants is what a huge proportion of their revenue, of their actual profit, comes from special events, right? That the day-to-day operation of the restaurant supports the operation of the restaurant, and that the profit margin comes from special events. And so we believe that having that sort so strategically located, it really increases the economic viability of the restaurant.
James, I would add, I would agree with everything that they've said relative to restaurant, and would add that all of the projects do a great job with restaurants, but more importantly, from a city perspective, I think we could easily fulfill all of the square footage combined for restaurant. I feel very comfortable with that. The downtown waterfront master plan underway calls out three different restaurant zones just on the upland alone. There's no end to that product, and it is one of the higher revenue producing products as well. So I'm very comfortable with all of the projects, in particular, the more the better in every regard, be it casual or fine dining.
No more comments. I'm going to thank you. Good job, well done. Committee members, we're going to take a recess. For members of the public here for the 6 o'clock meeting, I want to apologize for this initial session extending beyond what we hoped. And I'm going to provide my colleagues here in the committee an opportunity for a quick bite to eat with the intentions to reconvene the meeting at 6:15. And we'll have to eat fast. We are providing an opportunity for. Public, please. There's a sign up sheet by the clerk's desk. Roxanne has it available, and there's one outside, I believe. Chad, you want to clarify?
Narcotic cops are located downstairs right on the outside of security. When they entered into the building, you should have filled out the comic cards if they want to speak. So there are cards downstairs.
Okay, so we're going with the comic cards.
Okay.
And they're available to be filled out for speaking purposes downstairs.
Okay.
And we'll be calling names out to accommodate both podiums in order to expedite the comment period and get as much input from the public as possible. And with that, we'll see you in about 20 minutes. Thank you.